There are places in the ocean where life looks like it shouldn't exist. Vast blue deserts, barren and nutrient poor, where almost nothing thrives. And yet, in the middle of this emptiness, a riot of color explodes in the form of coral reefs, home to one quarter of all known marine life. Flourish against the odds. How? This is the mystery famously dubbed Darwin's Paradox, a question that Darwin himself may never have asked, but one that holds the key to understanding not only coral survival, but the intricate cooperation of life itself. Corals are marine animals in the phylum Cnidaria, closely related to jellyfish and sea anemones. They build vast underwater structures known as coral reefs by secreting calcium carbonate. But what we see as a single coral is actually a colony of genetically identical polyps, each with tentacles and stinging cells used to catch food. Most importantly, these polyps live in close partnership with a variety of microbes that live inside their cells or on their bodies. Together, they create the vibrant, bustling ecosystems that make up coral reefs. 17 years before Charles Darwin published his famous book on the origin of species, he went into a rabbit hole on the origin of coral reefs and published a 200 pages monograph in 1842, in which he meticulously examined the geological formation of coral reefs in the Pacific. And 183 years later, as I was reading a book on coral reefs, I came across a catchy phrase called Darwin's Paradox after its first observer, the book said. The paradox was about how corals can colonize habitats where there appear to be very few nutrients in the water to support the massive formation of life. Supposedly, Charles Darwin encountered coral reefs of the Pacific, and he wondered how life can be so diverse and rich on these remote patches of the tropical oceans, only covering a fraction of the ocean floor, but supporting 25% of all described marine life. Coral reefs were referred to as the oases in ocean desert, and I, as a hopeless romantic, was hooked by that one pretty analogy. So like anyone with endless capacity for hyperfixation would do, I sat down and read Darwin's 1842 book overnight, expecting to encounter his confusion and wonder about the hyperproductive oases of the ocean desert, he observed. I expected to read his thoughts and hesitations, but instead, the book was full of geological remarks and hypotheses about the formation of atolls, lagoons, and the accumulation of calcareous sediment. I must admit, it wasn't an easy read, but the real problem was that I seemed to miss any reference to the nutrient content of the water, or even him questioning the existence of these ocean oases. He was focused on hypothesizing the geological formation of the coral reefs. So if Darwin never mentioned this, where did the term come from? It turns out the phrase Darwin's paradox wasn't related to Darwin at all. In his 1842 publication, he was thinking in millennia, in the slow, sublime shifting of limestone, not in nutrient cycles or microbial trade routes. The paradox, as we repeat it today, is a modern invention, a bit of clickbait that uses Darwin's famous name to get attention. A retroactive question plays into Darwin's mouth. How can reefs, bursting with life, exist in oceans that appear so barren? It's a poetic puzzle, but one Darwin himself didn't articulate at all. The term first appeared in the 1940s, long after Darwin. Still, whether or not he asked it, it's a question worth asking. Because the answer reveals something astonishing, not just about reefs, but about life itself. Coral reefs thrive not in spite of their harsh environment, but because of a brilliantly orchestrated collaboration. What looks like a single coral lump is a city-state, an economical wonder of cooperation and specialization. And this is where the story of the holobiont begins. The success of coral reefs in these habitats is a direct result of a collective effort of cnidarians and microorganisms, including bacteria, archaea, fungi, and algae, and even viruses, depending on whether you describe them as microorganisms or not. And the health of the coral reef relies on all these organisms functioning as a single unit, a meta-organism, referred to as a holobiont, in which all its living components are networked metabolically, working in a delicate balance to keep this ecosystem alive. The holobiont acts almost like a free market economy, where the coral is the state that provides the infrastructure, like a government. It hosts and interacts with different players in the market and sets the general rules of engagement in form of space, surface area, housing, nutrient flow, pH regulation, and protection. Within this coral state, the major industries of the system are energy companies. They come into play as photosynthetic dinoflagellates in this analogy. They use a different pigment for photosynthesis than plants and green algae. And instead of the green color we associate with photosynthesis, dinoflagellates appear in a golden brown color because of this pigment difference. Nevertheless, the energy they produce is still a green energy source for the system. Reliable, clean, low cost, and efficient. As they power the majority of the system, they receive protection from the coral state, as well as raw materials like carbon dioxide, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfate for their production lines. With these raw materials, dinoflagellates produce glucose, amino acids, and lipids that are largely transferred from dinoflagellates to the coral cells. In the coral's free market economy, bacteria and archaea are the dynamic middle class. Builders, cleaners, chemists, and guardians, constantly negotiating with the host and each other, quietly running the essential background processes that keep the economy balanced. Together, they form the hidden infrastructure that supports life on the reef. And the fungi are reefs' venture-backed chemical conglomerates. Part refinery, part pharmaceutical giant, part security firm, quietly arbitraging waste into wealth and policing the marketplace so the big power company and the countless middle class bacteria can keep contributing to the trade. Another major responsibility of fungi is to produce antibiotics to prevent harmful entities from setting up shop and changing the balance of the trade. Viruses are powerful, invisible agents that can destabilize or restructure the microeconomy depending on their behavior. They are not part of the economy per se, but they influence every sector, sometimes destructively, sometimes constructively. When viruses infect the dinoflagellates, they can cause a market crash, or in terms of biology, an ecosystem collapse. Some viruses lie dormant inside the host, like long-term death, hiding and waiting to resurface to crush everything in times of imbalance. A healthy coral holobiont has a diverse, flexible, and responsive economy. When shocks came in the form of heat stress, pollution, or infection, the system either adapts by reshuffling the microbial partners or collapses entirely. This is how coral reefs can survive life in nutrient-poor waters, with trade, cooperation, free competition, and regulation. With millions of moving parts, coral reefs manage to balance an unmatched beauty that covers over 300,000 square kilometers of the ocean floor. Unfortunately for him, Darwin didn't observe any of these dynamics. The energy producers of the coral holobiont were described by Carl Brandt just a year before Darwin died in 1882. Darwin saw the reef as a geological puzzle, but beneath those limestone atolls was an unseen economy of life, orchestrated by microbes that wouldn't even be named for another century, and dynamics we still don't fully understand today. And so, the true solution to Darwin's paradox doesn't lie in some mystical exception to ecology, but in this brilliant pact, forged in the nutrient-poor waters of the tropics, where everyone has a role and nothing goes to waste, and recycling is more efficient than Norway's. But like all economies, this one is vulnerable too. Since the early 1980s, the tropical sea surface heat index has climbed year on year. A half degree here, a freak heat wave there. At first, the holobiont absorbs the cost. Microbes tweak their enzymes. A new working class appears in the form of new bacteria and archaea species. And corals manage the heat. But every adaptation is a loan of time. And each year, we lose more and more corals. Sadly, rising global water temperatures are only part of the story. From the land, rivers carry nitrate phosphate runoffs. Fertilizers we have so greedily scattered across fields and lawns, down to the sea. These nutrients feed explosive blooms of algae, tilting the delicate balance of the life underwater. But corals cannot swim in the same way phytoplanktons do. And as the algae spread, they form thick, suffocating blankets over the reef, dimming the light, clouding the waters, and smothering the very foundation of the reef's ecosystem in a gloomy, greenish haze. Above all this looms the issue of overfishing. Many of reef's residents, parrotfish, blue tangs, and urchins, graze on the fast-growing macroalgae that would otherwise overrun the reef, competing with corals for space, light, and nutrients. When we remove the grazers, the system loses its maintenance crew. With no one mowing the algae lawn or cleaning the commons, squatters move in. Seaweeds take over the infrastructure and form dense mats that cover the corals. Light is blocked, gas exchanges limited, new corals cannot settle, and the market grinds to a halt under the biomass of freeloaders. When the coral holobiont can no longer manage the system, when the heat is too high, the nutrients too many, and the grazers too few, something breaks. Inside the coral cells, the energy factories, the golden brown dinoflagellates, begin to falter. High temperatures disrupt their photosynthesis machinery, causing them to leak reactive oxygen species. These are highly oxidative chemicals, which include hydrogen peroxide. They are highly toxic to both the dinoflagellates and the coral host. They damage proteins, membranes, and DNA inside coral cells, causing a catastrophic chain of events. With one last push to avoid the collapse, coral expels the dinoflagellates entirely. Without the colorful dinoflagellates, coral turns into ghostly white, but it's still alive. This is what we call coral bleaching. With the energy producers gone, the economy stalls. If the environmental stress disappears quickly, corals can reacquire their power plants. However, with the increasing surface water temperatures, ocean acidification, overfishing, algae blooms, it becomes harder and harder for the holobiont to recover from a bleaching event. In 2024, the fourth global coral bleaching event took place, the second one in the last 15 years. It's hard to estimate the global loss. But some sites in the Chagos archipelago in the middle of the Indian Ocean reporting that 23% of the region's live coral cover had been lost. The future looks grim and dark, yet hope persists. Researchers are uncovering the astonishing adaptability of the coral holobiont. Some corals shuffle their symbionts, adopting tougher, heat-resistant strains. Some host probiotic bacteria that stabilize internal conditions and ward off pathogens. Once overlooked, fungi produce natural antibiotics and may help corals resist disease and recover from bleaching events at a higher rate. And viruses sometimes may bring genes that make their microbial hosts more resilient to warming waters in the Anthropocene oceans. Scientists are even selectively breeding corals in nurseries, training them like athletes to withstand higher temperatures before replanting them on degraded reefs. So there is hope, an opportunity to do research. The paradox Darwin never asked has led us to answers he never imagined. Coral reefs are not static rock gardens. They're dynamic societies, microbial cities. And if we listen, if we invest, if we act, perhaps we can keep this ancient economy from going bankrupt, not by preserving it in a museum jar, but by helping it evolve with the changing world which we are responsible for. We are part of the Earth's holobiont after all, and as we just learned from the corals, the whole cannot survive if the parts of it are collapsing. Thank you for watching the second episode of the Microscopic Odyssey. While making this episode, I experienced many emotions. It's very sad to see what's happening around us. But reading these papers of brilliant researchers working in a lab trying to create biological solutions to this depressing problem made me feel so very hopeful. Please don't forget to subscribe, and if you can, please head over to Patreon and support the channel. I am the only person behind it all, and your support is vital to the survival of the show and sustainability of the high quality content. The link is in the description. And I'm sort of a lone polyp, and I don't use my voice this often. I felt like I was losing my voice towards the end of the episode. See you in 2 weeks. Bye!